So the first session we finished at curve fitting, and there we had two parameters x and y. We plotted y versus x with the help of plot command. So we had x is equal to, I will just repeat it quickly. We had x from 0 to 5, and then we generated y with the help of element wise operator. And this is the element wise operator, this is the raised to the power. And then we use the plot command. And in the plot command, we converted this plot in from a line plot to a markers, and we had switched the line off. And then we had gone to tools, then basic fitting. In basic fitting, first we had selected linear. So when you select linear fit, a line will appear. That is a fitted line will appear here. The markers show the actual experimental data, and this shows the linear fit. And if we also click on show equations, the regression model will also be shown. And if we do a quadratic fit, then we will have a quadratic fit also and its corresponding model also. Okay. So now let us go to our next part. That is, now we will see some optimization applications of MATLAB. The first problem we will take is a simple one. That is, consider a plane x plus 2y plus 4z is equal to 7. Right? So it's a three-dimensional plane. So what we have to do is to find the point on the plane nearest to the origin. Now basically, we have to find the distance from the origin to a point on the plane which is nearest to the origin. And obviously, the shortest distance is which is perpendicular to the plane. So the perpendicular joining the origin to the plane will be the shortest distance. And we know the distance formula is x1 minus x2 square plus y1 minus y2 square plus z1 minus z2 square whole under the root. So here we have taken the point on the plane as x1, x2 and x3. And since the second point is the origin having all the three coordinates as 0, so we will have the relation that x1 minus 0 whole square plus x2 minus 0 whole square plus x3 minus 0 whole square under the root. That is the distance formula. So within the root, we simply get x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square. So we have to make it minimum, we have to minimize it. So what we will do is, we'll use a function of optimization in MATLAB, LSQLIN, that is least square linear. So if any problem can be solved by least square linear approach, then we can use this function. Now, what is the syntax of the function? The syntax of the function is, the name of the function is LSQ for least square, LIN for linear. Then there are some parameters. Right? So we will just see what are these parameters. You are already familiar with the function now, roots. Roots we used. So roots was taking one parameter. That parameter was the vector of the coefficients of the polynomial. So objective function here is to minimize x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square. Now, we are going to rewrite this objective function in a slightly different way as cx minus d whole square. So here, what we have is basically this, what is c and d? These c and d appear here in the least square function. So now what will be c, what will be d? So c will be basically an identity matrix and d will here be a zero matrix. So remember we discussed the I function for creating an identity matrix and a zeros function for creating a zero matrix. So we will use those here, right? So with this. And what is AB? Now AB, AQ, BQ, they refer to constraints. So by now you are familiar, there are essentially two types of constraints: inequality constraints and equality constraints, right? So A, capital A and small b is related to inequality constraints, and capital AEQ and BEQ are related to equality constraints. Now in this problem, there is only one constraint, that is the point that you find, it must lie on the plane. Now the point we have taken is x1, x2, x3, and we know our model of the plane is x plus 2y plus 4z is equal to 7. So this point x1, x2, x3 must satisfy this equation, that is x1 plus 2x2 plus 4x3 must be equal to 7. So that is the constraint we have taken, x1 plus 2x2 plus 4x3 is equal to 7. Now because of this equality constraint, our AEQ will be equal to 1, 2, 4. That is the coefficients of the design variables, right? Now you know from the previous session that x1, x2, x3 are the design variables. So they are the 1, 2, 4 are the coefficients of that, and BEQ is the constant, that is the on the in the constraint. And then we will put these values here. So remember, there is no inequality constraint. So what we will do is we will put a null bracket here of A and B. So what we will do, we will issue these commands in MATLAB. We will say capital C is equal to I, 3, small d is equal to 0, 3, comma 1, AQ this, BQ this, AB null, and then we will call this function. So let us go to MATLAB and do this. Let me resize them so that we can see MATLAB and these because we need to know the values of these. Right, so I'll put them over here. I'll close this figure window. So let me clear the workspace in MATLAB and clear the command window also. So now we have to create a variable C with the I command. So we say C is equal to I, 3. So our the identity matrix is created. Then we say small d is equal to zeros, 3, comma 1. So a column vector of zeros is created. Then we say capital A is equal to null, small b is equal to null, then capital A EEQ is equal to 1, comma 2, comma 4. You can also see here I have not put a comma in the PowerPoint, because in MATLAB, you can either use a comma or a simple space to separate the elements in a row. and BEQ is a scalar only 7. Right? So we have created all the parameters C, D, A, Q, B, Q, A, B. Let me now clear the command window. Now we will call this function LSQ, LIN, and give it all the parameters C, D, capital A, small b, capital A, EQ, small b, EQ. Now when this function, when I will press enter, the function will be executed. And this function will return two values. One is the values of x1, x2, x3. And second is the distance between the origin and the plane. That is a distance between 0, 0, 0 and x1, x2, x3. So usually because it will go to return me two values. So what I will do is I will put here x, f. So I will mention two variables which will take the two parameters returned by this. So remember, the first parameter x will be a vector because it will contain three values x1, x2 and x3. And second parameter will be a single value, that will be the distance between the origin and the point on the plane. Right. So it says that x is equal to 0.33, 0.66, 1.33 and the distance is 2.33. So we have used this example just to familiarize you with the optimization functions. Now the next two examples we will use, they will be more close to optimization because this kind of problem you may not come across in optimization books. Anyway, it was just an example. It can appear in a different form. So let us So let us discuss our next problem. Now this is a problem taken from an optimization book. A firm produces an alloy which must have the following specifications. Monica, are we recording the session? Okay, thank you. Right. So, a firm produces an alloy which must have the following specifications. The specific gravity must be less than or equal to 0.98. Chromium content greater than or equal to 8%. Melting point greater than or equal to 450 degrees Celsius. The alloy can be made using the following raw material. So there are three raw materials, A, B and C. A has a specific gravity of 0.92. A has a chromium content of 7% and A has a melting point of 440. Similarly, B has these three values for the three properties and C has these three values for the three properties. Then the cost of raw material per ton is given as A is rupees 90, B is rupees 280 and C is rupees 40. Find the proportion in which A, B and C must be used to obtain the alloy at minimum cost. So our specific gravity must be less than 0.98. So we can see here that C has a higher specific gravity, so probably C we may not use at all, but then the chromium content should be greater than or equal to 8%. So A has a chromium content which is less than 7, so we may not use A at all. And melting point must be greater than or equal to 450. So that also for A is less than that, so we may not use A at all. So that means we are left with only B as far as these three properties are concerned. But then B is quite expensive, rupees 280. So we have to see how do we solve it. So like yesterday, Dr. Deepam discussed with you the graphical method, and that is simplex method. We can use those methods. But let us see how do we use MATLAB. In MATLAB also, we'll be using similar things only. But of course, the method is very small. You just mathematically define the model as you would normally do on a piece of paper, and then you use the MATLAB function directly. So let us say x1, x2, and x3 be the fraction of the raw materials of A, B, and C, respectively, used to prepare the alloy. That is, x1, if the total fraction will be, total value will be 1, so x1 will maybe 0.3. In the ratio, x2 may be 0.5 and x3 may be 0.2. The total ratio must be 1. The objective function is we have to minimize this cost function. So 90 is the cost of material, per unit cost of material A, 280 is the per unit cost of material B, and 40 is the per unit cost of material C. x1, x2, x3 are the fractions we are taking. Now, what are the constraints? The constraints are, one, there we have inequality constraints. That is, when combined, the specific gravity must be less than 0.98. Now remember, although we are saying alloy, but as a problem, we are handling it as a mixture basically, because an alloy can have a property which is not totally depending upon the addition of the properties of the strict. That is there in the case of mixtures. So, their one inequality constraint is based upon the specific gravity. The specific gravity must be less than 0.98. Then the chromium content must be greater than 8%. And the melting temperature must be greater than 450 degrees Celsius. Then we have the equality constraint as well, that x1 plus x2 plus x3, these three fractions must add to 1. Or if you are taking them in percentage, they are must be equal to 100. Now we also have a lower bound, because when you are solving something mathematically, the answers can be positive, it can be negative. But it is a real world problem. So x1, x2, x3 should be greater than equal to 0. They cannot be negative. So what we'll do is we'll use a MATLAB function linprog for linear programming. So we don't have to make any diagrams. We don't have to apply simplex method in steps, in iterations, but we simply use the function linprog. And you see here, linprog has a syntax similar to lsqlin. First is the objective function. Then A and B refer to inequality constraints. AQ, BQ refer to equality constraints, and LB is the lower bound, because here what we have is x1 greater than or equal to 0, x2 greater than or equal to 0, x3 greater than or equal to 0. We call them bounds. You can also include them in inequality constraint, that is also fine. The results will be same. But because here we are referring to individual variables, individual design variables, so we call them lower bounds or upper bounds also, if there is any upper bound. So here, friends, we have the objective function, the inequality constraints, the equality constraint, and the lower bound. So how we will define the objective function? Objective function will be defined as a vector of 90, 280, and 40. So objective function is defined as a column vector of 90, 280, and 40. Capital A is the coefficients of inequality constraints, that is 0.92, 0.97, 1.04, 7, 13, 16, 440, 490, 480. Right? You can see here, these are the coefficients. So there's a chat box, there is a question, how do we define a particular syntax? Syntax we are not deciding, we have to decide which function to use. So if your problem is related to linear programming, you will use the linprog function. So the syntax, the linprog function has a fixed syntax. So we have to work according to that syntax, right? Like when you're solving problems in OR or optimization, there also you to apply a certain algorithm, you have to transform that problem statement into a standard form. It is that thing only. But the first thing is we must know, either on our own or by referring to the literature, to the books, that this problem falls under which category. Is it linear programming? Is it dynamic programming? Is it a transportation problem? Is it an assignment problem? That we must know. In that, MATLAB cannot help us. But MATLAB will help us in automating the calculation part. So there's a question, which book you see? You can refer to any book on optimization or operational research. The standard books that apply in the market. Like I have two optimization books. I will share with you after the session. Anyway. So let us come back to this. So our capital A is the coefficients of the constraints. But now just pay attention to this. Here our coefficients are 0.92, 0.97, 1.04. It is fine. 0.92, 0.97, 1.04. Next one we have 7, 13 and 16. But I have written minus 7, minus 13 and minus 16. Similarly, next is 440, 490, 480. But I have written minus 440, minus 490, minus 480. Why so? Because when we are using the linprog function of the MATLAB, all the inequality constraints must be of a type less than equal to. They cannot be greater than equal to. So by multiplying the second and the third inequality constraints with minus one, we will convert them to the less than equal to constraints. So that is why we have put a minus sign here. Similarly, in B also, that is the values on the right hand side of the constraints, we have 0.98 because the first one was already less than equal to. Second one is now minus 8, then third is minus 450. Then we come to equality constraint. Equality constraint, of course, the coefficients are 1, 1, 1, and right hand side is also 1. So we have AQ 1, 1, 1, BQ is equal to 1. And lower bound is what? 0, 0, 0. It cannot be less than 0. So we'll now go to MATLAB and apply this. So what I can do is I can also just copy this from here to MATLAB so I don't have to type it again and again. Just copy and paste over there. Let me clear the previous results. Right. So I will now put a semicolon at the end so that in the screen we can see all the variable that we have created. So you can see in the workspace, F has appeared. Now what is this A? I'm copying and pasting here. Right. So A is also there. Let me increase the size. Then B. Copy and paste, then AEQ, copy and paste, then BEQ is of course 1, I will just type BEQ is equal to 1. And lower bound is also 0, 0, and 0. So we have all this. Now we have to type the linprog function. So linprog function, see the syntaxes are similar. The objective function, comma, the inequality constraints, the equality constraints, and the lower bound. So this function, like LSQILIN, will return two values. First value will be the vector of x1, x2, x3. Second will be the cost. What will be the cost of that, right? So we just say length rod, and then we assign two variables x and sorry, f is already as a function, so let me call it c for cost, right? X and c, x for the values of x1, x2, x3, and c as the cost, right? So what I get is that x1 should be 0.5. That is 50% of the material should be A, B should not be taken, 50% should be material B, C, and then the cost per unit cost of the alloy will be 65 rupees. So let us look at the problem once again. So because our B was costly, so obviously in our model, when we modeled it and we applied the algorithm, it just came out to choose 50% from A and 50% from C, and all the conditions will be met. Now my request is that you can also try this example manually. Use the drawing method by on x and y axis, you draw the lines for the constraints, and then you find the corner points, then you find the Feli function, and similarly apply the simplex method also manually. Now basically MATLAB, what MATLAB is doing is it is also applying some algorithm. So when we use a length log, MATLAB also applies some algorithm. Now MATLAB will, because they are the programs written by the software engineers of MATLAB, so they use different algorithms. For example, the link prog function uses three algorithms, right? One is called initial interior point algorithm, second is active set algorithm, third is simplex. So there are three algorithms it uses. Let me just write. And we should not be very much bothered that what are those algorithms, because that will save us time. But if you have time, do try to find out. So I will just write the names. One is interior point algorithm. Second is active set algorithm, and the third is simplex, right, with which you are familiar. But the default algorithm is this. So when you use MATLAB, it uses interior point algorithm by default. Now if you want to use simplex, you can do that also. So there is a method of doing that. I will explain that also, because I will try to tell you the bare minimum things that you may need. Now, before I tell you that, let me draw your attention to something. Now, when we have found this, x has come out to be 0.5, 0 and 0.5. But if you look in the workspace, you will find the value of x as 0.5, then x1 as 0.5, x2 as 2.5069 into 10 raised to the power minus 14. So that is equivalent to 0 only. So but here it is showing 0 only. But actual value has been found to be 2.5 into 10 raised to the power minus 14. And third value also 0.5, which is being shown, right? Now let us say, do one more thing. We have used an LB, lower bound. Let us use the upper bound also. So what we will do is, we will say that because material A costs more than material C. Remember here, material A is for rupees 90 per unit cost and C is rupees 40 per unit cost. So I may put a upper bound on the material A. So I don't, I would like that, let us say I don't want to use it more than maybe 40% or 30%. So the remaining can be B or C, anything. Or because already B is not coming in the picture, but I can also put a constraint on B that I say that B should not be more than say 10% in case it is, it has to be there. And on C, I don't want any limit. So on C, I can say it can be 100%. I don't mind it. So I will put an upper bound off on A, B, and C and change our problem. And then see what result do we get. So we already have F, A, B, A, Q, thing defined. So I'll define another vector, U, B for upper bound. So A, I don't want more than say 40%. It has come out to be 50%, like by infraction 0.4. Then A, not more than 10% in case it has to come into the picture, 0.1. And C is the cheapest, so it can be full. I don't mind. I will put it 1.0 or 1 only. So we have defined a upper bound also. Now we will call the function again. Right? So to call this command again, I can either just copy and paste it, or if I here I press the up arrow key, the previous commands will appear here. So then I can select a command here by your mouse pointer. But let me keep this name something else. Earlier I had used X and C. Now this time let me use it Y and CT for the cost. So we want to compare the results obtained with only lower bound and with, now I add an upper bound here also. Then I press enter. So now it gives me that Y is 0.40. So B has now also come into the picture, right? In fact, C has slightly reduced from 50 to 0.49, but you can round off it. So A is 0.4, B is this. And now naturally the cost has increased. So it is better if I don't put a upper bound on my material A. Although it is the second cheapest, but let us not put upper bound because that is only increasing the cost further. Okay. So now we can see that if we don't put a upper bound, then our X, that is the fractions were 50%, 0% and 50%. And our cost was 65 rupees. But if I put an upper bound in trying to reduce the cost further, I am limiting X. Then I am getting Y as this and cost as this. I can also change the upper bound. Upper bound, like I used 10% for material B, but I can put it 5% or 0.05. But then sometimes what happens is if you put the constraints due to which the result may not be achievable, then you will get some warning messages. Because when you are doing, for example, on your using a drawing method, you can just see visually that, okay, what is the feasible region I am getting from where I will get the solution. So that is why I said that you also solve these problems using the graphical method and simplex method so that you get a feel of it. Then you can use the computer for future use. Now one, so here we have covered almost everything regarding linprog, that is the function, the objective function, the inequality constraints, the equality constraints, the lower bound and the upper bound. Now one thing is left, that is how to change the solver. Like I want to use a simplex because I am familiar with simplex, or say I have manually solved a problem using simplex method. And now I want to see the result of the computer with simplex method only. So how do I choose the simplex method? So there are two steps we will need to do for this, for changing the solver. So what is those two steps? We will take some variable. I call it anything, OPT for option, or maybe SOL for solver, anything, just a variable name. Here we have to use an inbuilt MATLAB function which says optim options. Now this is there's a query that to repeat the upper bound. We will do it again in our next problem also. We will use, next problem will also be linear programming problem, and we will repeat the whole thing there also, because the problem will be different, so it will be more interesting and more understandable. So this is a MATLAB inbuilt function, optim options. In fact, optimization toolbox function, optim options. Here we tell that in the name of the function, I am using linprog, so I will say @ linprog, comma. Then in single quotes, I will say algorithm, because I am going to use a different algorithm now. Comma, in single quotes, I will say simplex. Now, let us again pay attention to this. Optim option is used to change the default algorithm. So first of all, we give the name of the function with a @ sign in the beginning, that this is the function in which I am going to change the default algorithm. Then what I'm going to change? I'm going to change the algorithm. So you have to put in single quotes, and also A has to be capital. MATLAB is case sensitive. Here small a is different than capital A. And then what algorithm I want to use? Simplex. Here it is all in lowercase within single quotes. So once we do this, we give the command. Now MATLAB has noted that you will be using a simplex algorithm. So I will use the this without upper bound, because we will have to compare the results. So instead of x, let me call it now xp for x proportion, and for c we use cost. Everything else is same. I am not going to use here upper bound, but the syntax is, if I want to choose the new, I want to use the new algorithm, I will need to put sol somewhere over here. I am not going to use upper bound, so I will just put a blank, or you can say null matrix here. We call it a null. After this, there is another parameter which I am not going to use. I will just explain to you, and then I will say sol. So now this tells MATLAB that this is the objective function. These are the inequality constraints, equality constraints, lower bound. There is no upper bound. And this is for initial guess. Initial guess we will not give, because in any case, simplex does not need an initial guess. So even if I give here some value of x1, x2, x3, that will not be considered for the solution. And then I am saying sol. So sol I have set equal to simplex. Right? Okay. So now you see the result is same. 0.5, 0, 0.5 and 65. But if you look in the workspace, xp is now 0.5, exactly 0 and 0.5. Whereas x was 0.5. 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 14 and then 0.5. So if you solve this method by simplex, approach, you will find it will match with your manual. The results will match with your manual results. So friends, we are recording this session. We'll be uploading it in the cloud, the Google Classroom, perhaps by today evening. Why I'm saying perhaps by today evening? Because I have to download it from the cloud and then upload it on the Google Classroom. So that sometimes takes time. They are quite heavy videos. So I'll try it. It's available to you by evening or by tonight. So linear programming, which is perhaps the first thing you do in operation research or optimization. So we have learned quite a lot about it now, that how to use it in the MATLAB. Now we will discuss a second problem. For that problem also, we will use the linprog function. So let us see what is the second problem. So this we have done. The second problem is about the machine utilization. So there are three machines, M1, M2, M3, and there are three products, P1, P2, P3. Right? Product 1 needs 2 minutes on machine 1, 4 minutes on machine 2, and 2 minutes on machine 3. Product 2 needs 3 minutes on machine 1, it doesn't need any processing on machine 2, and 5 minutes on machine 3. Similarly, product 3 needs 2 minutes on machine 1, 3 on machine 2, and it doesn't need any processing on machine 3. Then the machine capacity has been given in terms of minutes per day. So machine 1 can run at the most 440 minutes in a day. Machine 2 can run 470 minutes a day, and machine 3 can run at the most 430 minutes in a day. The profit per unit for products 1, 2 and 3 is rupees 4, 3 and 6 respectively. So determine the daily number of units to be manufactured for each product to maximize the daily profit. So naturally here we are trying to maximize the profit. In our earlier problem, we were trying to minimize the cost. Now we are trying to maximize the profit. So there is one difference here. Now we are dealing with a maximization problem. So let X1, X2 and X3 be the number of units of product 1, 2 and 3 respectively produced daily. So what is the objective function? It is, sorry, not minimizing, but to maximize this. Let me correct it. Right. So the objective function is to maximize the profit. So remember, rupees 4 is the profit for product 1. So total profit will be 4 into X1, where X1 is the number of units of product 1. Similarly, 3x2 will be the total profit for product 2, 6x3 will be the total profit for product 3, and total profit will be this. Then we have the constraints. So we have inequality constraints. What are the inequality constraints? The machine 1 cannot run for more than 440 minutes a day. Machine 2, not more than 470 minutes a day. And machine 3, not more than 430 minutes a day. So naturally, this 2, 3 and 2 is the time which product 1, product 2 and product 3 need. So if we are making X1 units of product 1, then the total time on machine 1 for product 1 will be 2x1. Similarly, 3x2, 2x3, and this is a total time for which machine 1 will run. This has to be less than or equal to 440. Similarly, for the second machine and the third machine. Then we have the lower bounds. All the X1, X2, X3 has to be 0 or positive. It cannot be a negative value. You can see here the things are same. We are using the linprog function. The syntax you are already familiar. Now pay attention to the objective function. Whereas the objective function is 4x1, 3x plus 3x2 plus 6x3. Here we have written minus 4, minus 3 and minus 6. Why so? Remember here the objective function is to be maximized. But the linprog function will always minimize the objective function. So what we do is we multiply this profit with minus. Now in trying to minimize it, it will be the maximum value on the negative side. So you just take the magnitude and that will be the maximum value of the profit. A here, there is no change because A, all the inequality constraints were already less than equal to. B is also okay. And there is no equality constraint, so they are blank. And then we have given upper bound of 0, 0 and 0. So here first we will do with this, then we will also go to upper bound also. Okay. So let us go to MATLAB. And let us just copy and paste to save time. So we copy it. Then we go to MATLAB. Just clear the screen. And let us just change the name of the function, right? So this is our second problem of this type. So we call it F2. And similarly, I can also just call A as A2. So we will copy it. We go to MATLAB, we paste it. I also give it some other name, A2, right? And then we copy the right hand side of the inequality constraints. And we also name them as B2. We name them B2. And then we AQ, BQ, I'll just put there the null brackets, and LB, lower bound, I'm going to type it there. So we call, let us call it LB2 also. 0, 0, and 0. Right. Now we call the linprog function. Let us call it now Z and FOPT, you know, for optimized profit. So Z will contain the number of products, the number of units for product 1, product 2 and product 3, and this will contain the total profit. So we call linprog the objective function, the coefficients of inequality constraint. Then for, because there is no equality constraint, I will just put here null bracket. Again, for the equality constraints right hand side, and here I will put LB. Okay. So we get the result. We get Z as 0, 42 and 157. It says do not make product 1, make 42 units of product 2 and 157 units of product 3. And the maximum profit is minus 1.0667 into 10 raised to the power 3. So just ignore the minus sign, multiply 1.0667 by 10 raised to the power 3 and you will get 1066, right? So in our next step, we will make some changes to the problem. So what we can do now is, you see, we are getting the number of units of product 1 as 0. So, but maybe I have to supply, say, at least 10 units to that of the product to some. I already have an order with me for supplying 10 or 20 units. Right? So I can change the LB. I can change the lower bound. So we will say LB 2 as 10, 0 and 0. Right? Now we will again call the function. I have changed, already changed the value of LB2, so it will be now 10, 0, 0. Now we press enter. So we get 10, 44 and 143. And of course, the profit has reduced by a little amount. Now it is 1033 rupees. So also say now the second one is coming to be 44, but I don't need more than 30 of them. So I can give a upper bound for that. So what we will do is we will get to create a variable upper bound. Just we name it UB2 anything. Now for the first one, upper bound can be anything, right? So it can be 20, 30. I will give say 25. For the second one, I don't need more than 30. Because the third gives me the maximum profit. So I want to give a very large upper bound to it. So let me give any value, 200. It will be within that only. And now I call this function again. Now we also give the upper bound UB2. And we will see what result do we get. So now you can see here, earlier I was getting 10, 44 and 143. Now I am getting 10, 30 and 143. Because the constraints are such that we are not able to produce more than 143 units of product 3. Although that means the total production has decreased, but the product 2 is now limited to 30 components because product 2 may be such that we don't need more than 30, right? There are not many orders for it. So the profit is also reduced to 990 rupees. So that is how you can use lower bound and upper bound, right? Also, as I said, LinProg by default uses the interior point algorithm. If you want to use the simplex method, then we have to again put the sol thing here. We have already created a variable sol, which knows that. So if I type here, what is sol basically? S-O-L. If I type it here, it will give me a long detail of sol. It's a LinProg options. Option used by current and simplex. Right, simplex, diagnostic or display this, right? So we will not pay attention to this, but we know if we use the variable sol for solver options, then my LinProg function will start using the simplex method. It will use the simplex method whenever I include sol in the LinProg. Otherwise, it will use the default algorithm of interior point algorithm. So let me see the chat box if there are any questions. So we have just shown you linear lower bound, upper bound. I will use one more example, show you one more example today. Not from linear programming, but some other one. And in fact, the next thing you go after linear programming is transportation and assignment problem. So for transportation problem and assignment problems, we don't have as such any inbuilt function in MATLAB. We have to write code for that. So that we will see tomorrow how to do it. So we will just see first how do you do the programming and then how do you write the code. Okay. Now let me take, we will share the classroom, Google Classroom again. Let me take one more example. But to take that example also, I will first show you on the PowerPoint. Then we will go to MATLAB. So this is the earlier two examples were very clearly defined in terms of what actually it is. Now I'm taking a very general example of what is called as unconstrained optimization. So here my purpose is to show you the use of MATLAB. So because my personal area of working is automation, right? Optimization is not my core field because of in automation, in mechatronics or in simulation, we use MATLAB a lot. Right? So I am just showing its usage and optimization. If you have any questions or regarding to core optimization techniques, you can ask our experts. Tomorrow we will have two sessions by Dr. Sanjay Jain. And day after tomorrow, we will have two sessions by Dr. Lachwani. So Dr. Sanjay Jain and Dr. Lachwani, they are from the Department of Mathematics. They can answer all the questions which pertain to core optimization, right? So let us see this. Now, it is a question of minimizing a function, and the function is what? E raised to the power x1 multiplied by 4x1 square plus 2x2 square plus 4x1 x2 plus 2x2 plus 1. So there is no constraint here. X1 x2 can take any value, or their product can take any value. There is no constraint here at all. So it's an unconstrained optimization problem. So MATLAB has a function f min unc. F means function, min means to minimize, and unc means unconstrained. And its syntax is shown here. F min unc within brackets at the rate obj fun. Obj fun is this little objective function. So it is just the name of the function. Whatever is the name of the function, that is given here. Comma x0. So here x0 is the initial guess. So remember yesterday in discussion, Professor Pabla showed you local maximas, local minimas. So whether you get the correct result or not, that depends upon the initial guess. So if you refer to the books on optimization or operation research, there also you will come across the same thing. So similarly, f min unc will also give you correct result if your initial guess is correct. It depends upon you. But it will automate the process. You don't have to use pen and pencil, paper to solve the things manually. But depending upon your initial guess, the result you will get on using pen and paper or using MATLAB, the results will be same. So it is basically automating the things. It is improving your productivity by reducing the time that you spend in solving a problem. Okay. Now here, the syntax looks similar, but there is a slight difference here in obj fun. Now this is what is called as a user-defined function. So here, this, for example, this statement may vary. It can be anything. So I have to write a small code which will tell what is this. So this we have to code. Write a small program actually for this. So today we have now a limited time. So I will just discuss with you the essential things which are required for writing a code for this. Tomorrow we will discuss a transportation problem, and for that we will make a program, because for that there is no inbuilt MATLAB function. So we will make a program. So because we are going to make a program for that, you can do it either in MATLAB or as Scilab or any other programming language. But MATLAB and Scilab will be simpler because they will let you use the matrices directly. Otherwise, you can code that in C also anywhere. So let us go to MATLAB. Okay, let me show you this full slide first. So what this OBJ fun will look like? It is just a two-line program. I will just explain this to you when we go to MATLAB. And x0, we will take some initial value that depends, right? So I'm going to clear the computer. Now, before we go to programming, let us learn something else. So we have two values, maybe 4 and 7. We have already learned this thing, but just refreshing the memory. So x1 will be what? It will be 4. And x2 will be what? It will be 7. Because we are in a vector, it is not two dimensional, it's one dimensional. So by just giving a single index, I can access the values in a serial order. So if I want to write 4 square plus 7 square, right? 4 square plus 7 square. So I just want to write 7 square. Let me again write, let me try if it remains on the screen. I want to write 4 square plus 7 square. Okay, it is there. So what I'll do is I will write x1 whole square plus x2 whole square. Because x, then within parenthesis 1 refers to the first value and then raised to the power 2. Then x within brackets 2, it refers to the second value, then raised to the power 2. So if I write that, I will get the result 65. That is okay because 4 square 16 plus 7 square 49. So 49 plus 16 will be 65. So now when we are writing on paper, we write x1 and x2 like this, that x, then we write a subscript 1, x2, x a subscript 2. But in MATLAB, we will refer it as x within bracket 1 and x within bracket 2. So for us, x is a vector of two values here, and we will write x1 as x within bracket 1, x2 as within bracket 2. So let us clear this annotation. Let us resize it. And we will just see how to write it in MATLAB command, right? So we are going to write essentially this function in MATLAB. Yeah. So we are going to write this function in MATLAB. So what we will do is, so we say we have some vector x, right? We will give it the value later on. We already have vector of 4 and 7. So how we will write that this f function is equal to what? Now e, we can, the function is exp. Exp raised to the power x1. So we will write x1. Right? Then we will close the this parenthesis also, because this bracket corresponds to this bracket. Then multiplied with 4 into x1 square. 4 into x1 square. Then plus 2 into x2 square, plus 2 into x2 square, right? Plus 4 into x1, x2. So, because it's a long command, in MATLAB, I can distribute a long command over multiple lines. But we have to tell MATLAB that I am going to continue my command on the next line. So how do we tell MATLAB? By typing three ellipses or full stops. When we type three ellipses, MATLAB knows stability. I have to give one space actually here. So let I do it again. Let me do it. I'll just copy and paste this here. Then I'll give a space and give three full stops, right? So always give a space here, right? Then we have three full stops. So now MATLAB knows that we are going to continue the same command in the next line. So then we press enter. Now the next is plus 4x1, x2. So I'll say plus 4 multiplied by x1 multiplied by x2 plus 2 into x2 plus 1, right? So when you press a closing bracket, you will notice MATLAB always highlights the matching starting bracket, right? If plus this, so this one was highlighted. So I have created this f now. And because already x1 contains 4 and x2 contains 7. So if I press enter, this a value I will get for this function. But this is for x1, 4. Remember, this is our x. x1 is 4 and x2 is 7. Whereas we have to find the values of x1, x2 so that this function is minimum. So that is the this. So, now, because we have to write a very small program, although that program is just one line that we already typed, right? So let us do it today, because so that tomorrow we can start with our next problem of transportation. So I will just copy and paste it in a program now. I am just copying it. Now, how do we create a program? So, this, what we are going to create now is what is something called as a function file. So, I have to write function f is equal to this, this, right? So, I'll go to new. I will say new function. F is equal to, so here I will give the name. So there the name has been as obj fun. I can give it any name. I can call it objective o function, for objective function. 1, call it 1. And input arguments is only x here I will give. And whatever starts with a percentage sign, that is a comment. So I have already defined. Now I have ample space here, so I will remove these ellipses. For the timing, I will also remove these lines. Right. Okay. So when you start a function, you can write end at the last. Even if you don't write, it doesn't matter. So now you will see this. I will resize it. I am putting them side by side horizontally. So in the presentation, you see this thing looks exactly same as this function. So what we have done is, now it is okay. Right. So this is the function we have written in MATLAB. We have given it a name OFUN1 for objective function 1. So here in the PPT, it was written OBJFUN. So it was just a name. I can give it any name. So the keyword function just tells MATLAB that this is a function file. And then this is the output, name of the function, and input to the function. So, and then here we have f is equal to, here we have coded, what is this? So I have a function now. I save it. When you save it, it will be saved with the same name as ofun1. And the extension of the file will be m.m. Just like in Word, you have extension of docx. In Excel, you have extension of SLX. So similarly, here the extension is .m. So .m means it's a program file. So we save it with the same name as ofun1. So like we have used the MATLAB functions roots or optim options or linprog. Now we have created our own function ofun1. So if I go to MATLAB, remember, we already have a vector x 4 7. So if I say, if I call the function ofun1 and give it x, which contains 4 and 7, I will, oh sorry, you see, now another thing to see, by mistake I typed a capital X here, right? So whereas I had a small x here, so it gave me a message, undefined function or variable capital X. It is also suggesting, did you mean this? Because MATLAB noticed that there was a variable small x, so maybe the user wanted to use small x, but by mistake he has typed capital X. So I will just press enter. So ofun1 function was called with small x values, and we get the result f is equal to this. So we will continue tomorrow. If right now if there are any questions, let me see.